Going on, everybody. Tops are done. I'm Sammy Davies. That, somewhere else, is Dave McNee. You'll remember Dave McNee. He is the fittest pastor in all of the continent of Europe, politically, geographically, doesn't matter how you want to slice it. This guy is the fittest. And I believe that he, like myself, has just finished doing the quarterfinals. So we thought we would sit down and have another little chat about it. Dave, how are you doing?
Yeah, I'm all right. Thanks, mate. Yeah, we were sitting recording this on Friday. So we're both 4 days out from our various quarterfinal achievements or misachievements or misachievements.
We'll get there. How much CrossFit have you finished in the quarterfinals?
I've trained every day since the quarterfinal finished. So I've trained every day this week. It's actually been a real release to go, oh, I can just train for fun. I don't need to like think about peaking or anything like
I think you had a similar sort of sentiment at the end of the Open, didn't you? That it was just nice to get back to normality and what have you. Anyway, let's talk quarterfinals. That's where we're at. CrossFit Games Season 20. We both qualified. You were not just age group, you were general population quarterfinals as well. Yeah. Whereas I was just senior citizens entry allowed. MD2. What was your thinking going into the workouts being announced?
I guess so. Expectations before they got announced, I was just worried that there'd be more than one workout where I couldn't do something. So I was worried that it might be like half the workouts or 3 out of 4 workouts where there's just a barbell that I can't lift or some kind of high complexity, high skill stuff that just rules me out before I've even got a chance of doing the workout. And so when the workouts were announced and basically I could join in with everything, I was just relieved. Like, I was like, great, I can have a fun weekend.
So was there something maybe like in the team quarters that made you think, oh, I might not be able to do this? Or was it just like the background noise from the last couple of years of quarters where there have been much heavier weights being used and things like that?
Yeah, it was more from last year's awareness than what was going on in the team quarters. Like, as we've talked about before, I don't pay that much attention to the worldwide CrossFit kind of scene. So if you ask me what was in the team's quarters right now, I would have no idea. But certainly I knew what was in the quarterfinals from last year, and like that, the barbell workout that opened up with a really heavy weight. Was it cleans at like 120 or something like that?
Box jump overs, and then 25 kilos or something.
Yeah. And then there was another workout that was handstand walking where you had to go 21 feet or 25 feet unbroken. And I was like, if that equivalence to those kind of things come up and I'm like just basically ruling myself out of two of these workouts, it's going to be a disappointing use of my entrance fee. But I
had a similar vibe as well. I knew that I was on the bottom end, and I knew that age groups were going to be doing the same as the general population individuals workouts, which I just thought shifted just a little bit more to the difficult end of the spectrum for me. And I sort of resigned myself to genuinely not being able to do one of them or only being able to get so far in one and then having to stop. And I think that I was like satisfied with that being the case. And really what I was hoping was that there wouldn't be 2 zeros for scores, if that makes sense. If there had been 2 workouts where I just thought, right, that's a zero, then I probably wouldn't have bothered entering. That's sort of where I was. But when the workouts came out, I thought, well, here we go. We can at least have a stab at all of these. We can get going and we can rub shoulders with everyone in the gym, basically. The workouts, how did you attack them? What was the order that you went through them, like how many per day?
I did workout 1 on Thursday. That's pretty simple. Then on the Friday, I did the lifting workout because I wanted to be relatively fresh for that. It was going to kind of to PB territory for me. And then on Saturday, I did the wall ball and burpee workouts, because I knew I wanted to have a rest day after I'd done that workout. Rest day Sunday. And then on Monday, I did the gymnastics workout.
For me, and this is like a broader thing about the quarters, it was a totally different experience to any of the online comps I've done with the Open, European Championships, things like that in the past, where it's been one workout a week. I said last time about my redo philosophy, like you have to redo, otherwise you're daft. I've got enough space and wiggle room in my life to fit in a couple of CrossFit classes, doing these or open gyms, doing these, that sort of thing. But when the quarters got released with the time that you had to log them by, et cetera, it basically meant for me that my schedule was going to be two on the Friday, two on the Monday, like Olympics. So our box did workout one on the Thursday, so I missed that one. That was the intervals one, right? And then workout two on the Friday, burpees and wall balls. So I went to class in the morning, I did the burpees and the wall balls in the morning, then I went back in the evening to do the intervals workout. Saturday morning in Timor's. I'm not going to miss Timor's for a comp. I just enjoy messing around with my mates too much. But I gave it a go, like as the warm-up to Timor's was the clean and jerk one. And really got like shocked by the jump, like the 20 kilo jumps. I hadn't prepared enough. So as soon as I'd done it, I was like, right, well, that's being redone on Monday. So came in on the Monday, did work out three gymnastics, and then straight into the weightlifting one. So that was me. I did 2-1, and then realistically 3 and 4 on the Monday. And that was like dictated by circumstances as much as anything, and the windows that CrossFit had given us. So tell me, which was your favorite workout and why?
Well, definitely the workout one, the interval workout, was, I thought I had a great time. Like, that was it was pretty good me workout, and just like everything about that I enjoyed. And as well as the, like, both of the, it felt relatively wheelhousey for me, but also the sense of progress as well, of how I was able to handle the snatches going. A year ago, I couldn't have handled those snatches the way I did last week. And that's just, I find that always kind of thing that really rewarding of going, I know what a 60 kilo snatch did to me last year in the Open, and here's a 60 kilo snatch in the quarterfinals, and I'm able to move it.
So what was your strategy going into workout?
So that felt great. I was pacing it pretty conservatively, actually. Like, I was going, so I was like, make hay on the rower, because that's the fastest kind of place that you can accumulate extra reps. Go kind of steady singles on the snatches, but don't try and push all the way up to the end of the minute. Kind of finish snatching with 15 seconds to go to get on the rower, and then just move at a pace that I can just keep moving on the box step ups. And actually, as I went through the workout, I found I could push the box step ups a little bit harder than I thought I would be able to, and get a few more reps in there.
What was the score? What sort of pace did you hit?
Score for workout one, I got one. So I was hitting kind of 7 or 8 snatches around the kind of, started off at kind of 25 calories, ended up at 18 calories on the rower, and then about 15 or 14, 15 or 16.
That is going some.
Well, a mate of mine who I was judging beforehand, the snatches were not his thing, but he's a great, great cardio machine athlete. And so he was easing back completely on the snatches. And then the first round on the rower, he put 35 calories up.
That's a shift. So I benefited workout one, that I was doing it on the Friday evening. I had a whole day of scores from our gym, not just people who qualified from the quarters, but just that was the workout for the day in the gym. So I knew that sort of anything over would be a decent score, you know, like an actual good score is up in the 200s, but certainly there were people 150 something in my gym who I would look at and think they are respectable CrossFitters. They can do all of these things. So being in that ballpark would be good for me. Now, my PB snatch is 64 kilos. So I'm not like terrified of 61.
Okay.
Just generally, I'm pretty decent at multiple reps close to my PB on everything. It doesn't matter what if it's Olympic lifting, powerlifting, whatever. If I'm at that like 90% range or something like that, I feel like I can always do a decent job. So I wasn't scared of doing the 61s. Although I haven't really put that much on a snatch for a long time. But by the time it got to Friday evening, I started doing sums in my head. And I realized if I did 20 cals and 20 box step ups, that I could take a zero on all of the snatches and have 2 minute rest and beat all of these people who I thought were better at me at CrossFit. So what's the live reaction? I did not even set up a bar for the snatches. I got the empty barbell out, I put it on the floor as if to warm up. And I thought to myself, just don't bother me. Just hit 20 and 20 every round. Yeah. So I pulled on the rower until I got to 20 cals, stopped, had like 20 seconds rest before the box step ups, did the box step ups, which were I thought they were horrendous, and then took 2 minutes off.
Doing 20 in a minute of the box step ups is a lot. Like, not a lot of people were going for 20.
It was a good pace. Yeah. But that was like,
I can't believe you didn't even set up.
The boy I'd asked to judge me, like, to begin with, refused. He's like, if you're not going to do it properly, then I'm not going to judge you. I'm like, judge away, mate. Just give me a score of a zero. What can you do? So yeah, that was my tactic, and I feel naughty, but also like, there it is. I mean, if I literally couldn't do 61, that's what I would have had to have done anyway. And if you get given your like a choose your own adventure, then you decide the pace you want. And my pace that I decided was zero on the snatches. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, everybody else complaining about the grip fatigue after the workout, and Sammy's just standing there going, "I've just had 2 minutes rest. I'm fine." Thanks.
Fourth interval, my left arm felt like I wasn't even going to be able to pick up the handle. It was horrendous. I put the dumbbells down twice in that last round of box efforts. It was a mess. Real mess. And I actually only got 15 reps on that last round, so I ended up with a...
So the fun thing I had in workout one was that I did it with Tom Kingdom, and so he's a quarterfinal. He's qualified for the semifinals.
Tom
from
is now
our gym.
He qualified through to the semifinal, or has he had a massive scoring adjustment?
No, he's had two of his. Well, I spoke to him this morning. He'd had two of his videos reviewed already, and he's only had one rep removed from that. Yeah. So I did it with him, and during one of the intervals, because obviously I'm going at like normal person pace, and Tom is going at semifinals athlete pace. And so during one of the intervals, he looks over at me and then he tells me afterwards, he's like, "I was just that. Why did you look so calm and so relaxed?" Because I'm pacing it. I'm going at eight snatches around and like 15 or 16 box step ups. But Tom's going at semi-finals pace. So he's like cycling this barbell and is never breaking on the box. And so he just looked over at me. He's like, "I'm just stood there kind of calm, trying to lower my heart rate between rounds." And he's going at kind of ballistic pace. The semi-finals athletes are
so
different.
That was your favorite workout. I just generally like taking a step back, like that it was a different style of workout, that it was like the fight gone bad sort of approach, which I don't know if we've ever had that in quarterfinals. My memory's not that good. I don't think they've ever had that sort of thing, at least in the Opens that we've competed in. So I just really enjoyed that there was that little twist on it. And it was a good WOD for the class as well. Generally speaking, that was a sort of a win.
Yep.
Okay, how about workout two then? So potentially 150 wall balls and 150 burpee box jump overs. I've gone public saying that I enjoy a burpee, throwing myself to the ground and getting back up again. But it was so boring. Trying to count on those burpee box jump overs was just, it didn't matter what pace you were going, you seemed to never get closer to the actual number you were aiming for.
It was one of those ones where you're really relieved to have a judge with you, because I was just like, once I got onto the burpees, I was like, I'm put my head down here and I'm not even considering what number I'm on. I'm just waiting for my judge to shout at me, telling me that's 10 down, that's 20 down or whatever. And just kind of tried to zone out.
A couple of people did it immediately afterwards. And I was just like, I feel sorry for you, because there's nothing that I think redeemed that workout. It was hard. It was boring. It was just miserable. And yeah, I think everybody ended up agreeing exactly with that analysis. It was just a miserable workout. Quick question. How many?
One.
Yeah.
One.
So frustrating.
Right at the end, I got, I just tried to, like, for the last, like, I don't know, maybe 15 seconds, I kind of dug deep to try and put the hammer down a little bit. And I just, on my penultimate rep, just jumped, I rebounded straight off the other side. Lost that rep.
The same, just one. And it was like, come on, push. And you do a couple of step down pushes but like we're so, I think, used to doing the box jump overs in a certain way. And when you're rushing, that just feels like the intuitive way of doing it. And it was good to see that loads of people further into it got exactly the same situation, just autopilot almost. Jeff Adler, fittest man on earth.
Yeah.
He got dinged a couple of times for doing it. And you can just see the frustration bubbling up in him, because he's like, you know that you're not supposed to do this. You've already done 142 of them in the right way. That's... why are you getting it wrong on these last couple?
Yeah, and it's just wiped 4 seconds off your score. And that's like, you can see it in that kind of precise way. What was your score?
2, I think. So I was into my third round of wall balls. And my only thought was that I left it a little bit late to really push. So I was in like a pretty decent set then when I finished. I mean, I'm talking maybe I could have got 5 to 10 more reps. So there was no tears or anything like that. But I did. I finished it strong. I thought, maybe could have been dying a little bit more at the end there. But for 20 minutes, you know, it's hard to pace a 20-minute workout. How did you get on?
Yeah. Yeah. I thought I would get further through it than that. But then when I saw other people's scores, two of the guys who I train with a lot, and often we would score quite similarly on a workout like that, the three of us were all within like 5 reps of each other, actually. And now, of course, I was annoyed because they both pipped me. Like, one of them got me by 1 rep, I think. The other one got me by like 3 reps. But when I saw that, that's the window I'm in. I'm like, actually, probably.
So that one was a little bit more difficult for me to like even conceive of what sort of score or time would be good. I was in the 9:30 class, so that I don't think anybody had even logged their scores from the earlier class with us. And it's just like, just a complete, and I've got no idea how long 50 burpee box jump overs take. I know how long I can race 50 burpees. I don't know how quickly 50 burpees are going to take when I'm going to do 3 rounds. You know, it was just totally out of the blue. No idea. Just tried to move for 20 minutes and see how far we got. And yeah, I thought it was all right.
Did you break up the wall balls early?
I think I went into it. So that's a week ago now. I think I went 10. So that takes me to 30. And then I went to 5s. And that wasn't like a fatigue thing at that point. I think my strategy was, I'm just going to do quick 5s, but while I'm fresh, there's no sense in dropping. So I wanted to get to 30 and then slow it down a bit. The most frustrating thing of it all was one of the girls from our gym. She ended up, I think, like 217th in her age category. So she did really well. But like, it's just a fact that women can wall ball faster than men because of the difference in the height of the targets. Yeah, so she's not going faster than wall balls. Wall balls just are faster for women. My peripheral, I could see her, I could feel her burpee box jumping, and I was like, I've still got 10 reps to go. I'm already behind. And then, you know, we were both on the box jumps for ages, and then the first time I heard a wall ball hit the floor around me, and I'm just like, she's back on the wall balls already. This is a gutter, but I mean, she smashed me anyway. But there was just that was just two little bits of total demoralization so soon into the workout, so far behind. But yeah, I'm happy with that. So then for me, that's how we'd arranged it internationally. We'd had workout 1, the intervals on the Thursday, box jump, wall balls on the Friday. And they scheduled for our team was like a mashup of workout 3, workout 4. But split as a team. So we started, part A was the clean and jerks. And then as pairs, we had to do workout 3. So I asked the guy I was doing it with, I said, do you mind, like, just let me do the 60 kilo barbell? And then, you know, just count my time. And then we'll set up 2 bars and we'll basically not do it as a pair, if that makes sense. Which was good in terms of just getting a feeler and a test for it. But So 85 is my clean and jerk PB. So 80, what was it? 82, 83? Okay. Again, it was pretty much up there for me. And I just got smashed by it. First time I tried to jerk it because of the jump was just too much. So I got myself a score. But again, I thought I can probably do better than that on Monday. So I like just tucked it away in the back of my mind to redo on the Monday. And then the Monday was the handstands, toaster bar, rope climbs one. What did you make of that? quad three.
Well, the handstands, rope climbs, toes to bar one was an unmitigated
disaster. I cannot wait
disaster.
To hear this, especially knowing that I did pretty well. Like, yeah, I did all right.
So the first two movements there, kipping handstand push-ups, reasonable volume toes to bar, I'm quite comfortable with. And so I kind of went at a comfortable-ish pace for the like for those first three rounds, knowing I didn't want to blow anything out, but also I didn't need to dial back loads. Finished, so my tie break time was 6:08 that I got through the first three rounds. So I had then plenty of time. And I kicked up into a strict handstand and I immediately did three no reps. Wasn't going low enough.
Why were they no reps?
So I wasn't going low enough. I wasn't getting my head onto the mat properly. I was kind of doing that thing of like where you're a bit tense, a bit rushed, felt the line hit my hair and was going up, and my judge was like, Dave, you're not doing the reps. And so I'd done three, so I kicked off, I'd done nothing. And then I was like, okay, slow down, calm down, now do a proper rep. Do it properly. But by that point, I'd kind of just put a bit of fatigue into my shoulders and my midline was fatigued from the toes to bar. So I kicked up. I do my first rep and I do it properly, but it is so slow, slow grindy. And I arched my back so much in it that when I finished the rep, I kicked down and I could feel that I twinged my back by doing it just really with really poor form. And immediately I could feel this is not good. So shook it out, kicked up to go into my next handstand, and I just had no tension through any part of my body. There was like, I couldn't get tight. So I would descend down to the bottom of the mat, try and push up, and nothing would happen. And I must have done that like three times. And by this point, it's now just like, oh, there's loads of time left on the clock, and I can just see myself just not doing any work. So like, I even walk over to my bag, get my lifting belt to try and create some tension in my core, put that on. That helped a little bit. Managed to get like very slow singles going out from that point. And I finished with five strict handstand push-ups.
So you didn't even get to the rope climbs? Done.
And didn't even get to the rope climbs. Yeah. And what you would have like, what would have amused you was the like the kind of absolute tailspin this put me into afterwards. Of like the so, I've done a lot of work on strict handstand push-ups in the last year because I felt like they were a limiting factor last year. So I was kind of confronted with like two failures from myself in execution. One is that I've put the work in at this skill to be able to do it. And then I've just failed to execute doing it on the day. But also that all of the next things, I'm quite comfortable at rope climbs. So I was like having to do two sets of five rope climbs, I actually felt pretty good about. And so the skills further away, rope climbs, ring muscle ups, I can do those skills, but I didn't get access to those skills because I made such a mess of the handstands. And so I walked home from the gym in a complete grump, threw my bag down in the corridor, walked straight into the living room, which is where I'm sitting now, kicked up onto the wall in the living room and did two sets of strict handstand push-ups straight away just to prove to myself that I can still do
handstand. I mean, it was an amusing story anyway, but that aftermath is also quality.
Well, and then in true Sammy Davies fashion, I spent the rest of the afternoon, because I'd done this workout on Monday morning, the rest of the afternoon thinking, should I go back and do a redo? Could I somehow squeeze half an hour out of my, like, what else I have going on this day to just get back to the gym and see if I could do better? And I texted my friend Kelsey, who was there when I was doing it. She was judging me, actually. And she was like, if you try and do another 60 toes to bar before you try and do any more strict handstand push-ups, your midline's not going to feel any better when you need to be doing some strict handstand push-ups. I was like, fair enough. I think you're probably right. So I just took it on the chin. And I was quite comforted then that when the scores came out on Tuesday morning, actually the difference that made to my score overall was pretty minimal, actually. But I was in the Sammy Davies wanting to do a redo zone for a good few hours on Monday afternoon.
As it happens, that was one of the workouts where I had like a better idea of what it might feel like what sort of pace to go on, what have you. Because the European Championships qualifier had had this, I think it was a 2 kilometer row, but every 2 minutes you had to break the row and do 10 handstand push-ups. Which, when I ended up doing that workout 3 times, twice within half an hour of each other, because I'd taken so long on one of the sets of handstand push-ups, about 10 minutes into it, the screen on my rower had turned off. So I just took like 10 minutes and started again, and then got to like the same point in the workout and was just completely blown up, and I could now squeeze 10 push-ups into the 2 minute windows. I was that like roasted by it. Took 2 days off, redid it at home with another one of the guys doing it with us. Knew like at what point to stop and to break and to push and things like that. So I had like that experience from the start of the year of sets of 10, but multiple sets of 10, and like how far to go and how to break those up and all that sort of thinking. So I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, great, I love handstand push-ups. I love rope climbs. I can do toes to bar, but 60 is a lot. And also, true Sammy Davies fashion, I'm looking at the rules and I'm trying to see like loopholes. So one of the things I was genuinely exploring in the rules was, obviously, you don't have to do kipping. Strict is faster than kipping. You can kip the first. Now, my kipping handstand push-ups are awful. If I can get 3 or 4 out without unbalancing and falling off, then I've done really well. I find that I'm so slow on like the descent and getting into position that it's just more work for me. It's slower, it's harder. So I think I tried kipping the first two. I ended up going strict after that. So I stricted it the whole way just because that's what I practice, because I'm useless at kipping handstand push-ups anyway. But I was in the rules just making sure that was allowed. But then I got this idea. I was like, well, the wall facing is really a little bit more chest being brought in. So if I get fatigue from doing, 50 strict handstand push-ups, at what point am I allowed to like just go, do you know what? I want to do the harder one anyway and switch around. I couldn't really decide whether that was okay or not. And I thought, seeing as I pushed I'd like dipped my toe in that being naughty with not doing any snatches, I thought, do you know what? I'm just not going to bring it up. I'm just going to leave it. So yeah, the handstands for me were fine. I knew when to break. I think I broke sooner than like my body felt it should. I took decent like walking around at the box so that I had like a spot in the box to walk to so that I couldn't rush back into it, that sort of thing. The toes to bar for me were the hardest part. Like round 3, I was trying to do 4 sets of 5 and I was struggling to hold on, so I just went 5-5 and then 10 singles, I think. But rope climbs, absolutely one of my jams. So smash them out, except the penultimate rope climb. So that's where I was in the WOD. I think I had 30 seconds left and 2 rope climbs remaining, knowing that I could just get on the wall and do like a max set of wall facing handstands. I sort of felt like I could just squeeze out 10 at that point. So 30 seconds was pushing it. So I thought, I'm really going to have to sprint these two. Jumped up. And this is one of the most CrossFit excuses you're ever going to hear. I was wearing my brand new pair of rads. And
my feet just not completely slipped. Shoes.
And I was like, I don't know how to grip with these shoes on. Couldn't do it. And made such a mess of getting back into position. And it took me like 4 pulls rather than I normally eat quite easily do 2 pulls to get the rope. By the time I came down, so it had taken me 20 seconds when I thought I could probably do them both in 20 seconds. And my forearms were just utterly gone from like hanging and basically legless in up that last one really slowly that I didn't even attempt to do it. I thought, I'm not going to be able to hold on to the rope. So I just stood there for 10 seconds, 1 rope climb left, buzzer went, and as if to just prove the point that it wasn't the rope, like I wasn't done. I marched over to the wall just like, yeah, I can still do these. This is not a problem. But none of them counted.
That would be a really good excuse, because people know that rads are a bit slippy on a rope, particularly a new pair, except for the fact that you had already done 8 rope climbs by that point in the workout. So if you said, like, if that was your excuse because it went round and round on rep 1,
they weren't comfortable the entire time. It was a a sketchy 8 reps up until that point. Like there were a couple where first pull was good, second pull feet slipped a little bit. Never panic, don't panic, just collect your thoughts, go for like a little 2.5 pulls. So it was a bit frustrating in that sense. And yeah, you know, like I could sit here and I could say, right, we'll do it again. I'll maybe push the pace a little bit more on the handstands to give myself more time for the rope climbs, wear better shoes for the rope climbs so that they'll go easier. Could I have done 10 and broken wall facing? Probably not. Probably would have actually ended up being 2 sets. It's not a tremendous amount, is my point. None of the workouts, I think, I've left a lot out there. Like I did with, say, 24.1.
Yeah.
I did the redo. Took loads of time off. I knew that the score that I'd submitted wasn't my best effort, so I had to go back and do it. With these, I'm thinking, you know, like wall boards, could I have got 5, maybe more? Could I have gamed the box step-ups a little bit better, got 3 or 4 more reps? Maybe. That sort of thing. So I was generally like quite happy with that as well. But to my mind, that was the most fun WOD. That's the sort of WOD that I would just be like, oh, I've got nothing programmed. Let's do all of these handstands and rope climbs and goodness knows what. It was like the sort of thing that I would do again in a way that workout 2, clearly no one would ever repeat unless they were being or something.
Yeah, why would
you? So what about?
So did you then, after that, did you redo workout 4? After having had a kind of tester on Saturday morning.
As I said, the forearms was the thing that really went then at the end for me in workout 3. And I thought, I'm not even sure I'm going to be able to like finish the pull for the clean on these. And I was moderate, you know, I had a score, so I wasn't desperate to redo. I had a tie break time and I think I'd managed 3 clean and jerks. I'd failed 3, hit 3 on Saturday. I sort of had in my mind, I probably could do about 5. So again, there was like a little bit of wiggle room. Wouldn't have been desperate if I couldn't do it. Another guy in our gym was doing it, same age category as me, finished top 200. So he's in through to semi-finals. He was doing it and I just thought, well, I might as well try and warm up. See what it feels like when I get to that weight. And if it feels okay, then I'll go for it. If it doesn't, then I won't. I warmed up. He was doing it next to me. He'd said that he was going to give me the plates afterwards. I mean, he scored about 15 in the final round or whatever it was. Absolute machine. And I just wasn't feeling it. So I had 80 on the bar. And he said, are you going to borrow these? I said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to try it. If I hit this jerk, then I'll redo it. If I miss this jerk, then I'm just going to leave it because, you know, my energy levels weren't there, whatever. I hit the jerk. And I don't think I've ever been more disappointed to actually do complete the clean and jerk. So I dropped it and my shoulders just went down. I was like, oh, why did I say that I was going to do it? So yeah, got a hype, got a bit of energy going, managed to score 8. So I went from 3 reps on the 80 kilo bar to the 8 reps. And I missed 2 in the last minute, which was a bit annoying because it was feeling good. I think my 8th rep was one of those where my tendency is not to drop, but just to rely on my strict strength, like half jerk it and then push it out. So I'd done that on my 8th rep. I was thinking, stupid, 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 get down low, get down low. But my 9th attempt then, I just did exactly the same and I didn't have anything left to push it out. And that was it then. I was gone. My arms were gone. But yeah, I was happy. Really, really happy with that in the end.
And did you squat clean or power clean? And did you split jerk or push jerk?
I power cleaned. And when I was on the 80 bar, I split jerked. I did 1 or 2 splits on the 60, but you know, I'd warmed up a decent amount for it this time. I didn't feel like my jerk needs to be warmed up. I'd done a decent amount of split jerk into warm up, and I was just racing to get a better tie break time at that point. So, sort of push jerked the first bar, apart from 1 or 2, and then splits the whole way. But for you, it was the same sort of at your limit, just on the next bar. Is that right?
Yes, I guess similar. Although, so what did you say your PB was before your split? It was 85 kilo. Okay, so you were just under your PB. So before workout 4, my clean and jerk 1 rep max was 100 kilos. So I knew if I get anything on the third bar, it's a 2 kilo PB. And so now I'd only hit that 100 kilo PB maybe a month 6 weeks previously. And when I did, I felt great doing it. I was like, I was chuffed to join the 100 club. And I felt like I've got more in the tank, but I don't want to try and test if I've got more in the tank right now. I just want to I don't want to end this training session with a failure. I'd rather end it on a success. So whilst it was going to be a 2 kilo PB, I kind of felt like if I move correctly and with the hype of people watching here, I think I can hit this. And so I went at power clean the whole way through, and then push jerked all of the 60s. And then I push jerked the first 8 of the second barbell. And then I said to the guy judging me, I was like, I'm taking a breather. And then I'm going to split jerk the last two 80 kilos, 82 kilos or 83 kilos, whatever it was, in order to warm up for my one rep max attempt. So I did that. Two nice kind of comfortable split jerks at 83 kilos and then just took loads of time before I got on the bar for my new kind of one rep max attempt. And then hit it. And then I was like, okay, I've hit one. Everything else is a bonus now. To manage to hit it twice more. And then I took another attempt with like 12 seconds left on the clock and missed that one. But by that point, I couldn't have cared less. I was like, it was definitely, whilst I think the workout one was the one I enjoyed the most, the workout of kind of most achievement gained was the lifting workout, because I was able to go, I hit a PB 3 times under fatigue. A year ago, 2 years ago, well, a year ago, I wouldn't have been able to lift the third bar above my head. 2 years ago, I wouldn't have been able to lift the second bar above my head. So in terms of a sense of progress, sense
people
of
speak like the magic of the old world, getting your first muscle up, getting your first whatever it is, but stringing a couple of PBs together at that point, that's progress, isn't it? So yeah. When you transition from the 80 bar to the 100 bar, you took more than the 60 seconds rest?
Well, yeah, so I was sat down for 60 seconds, and then when the 60 seconds was up, like, I just kind of did the, like, I'm slowly putting on my lifting belt here, kind of just, like, yeah. I wasn't rushing onto the barbell for sure, because I was like,
yeah,
I've probably got more time here than I know what to do with. And I also, what I really didn't want to do was to miss the first lift. I was like, this is a PB attempt. If I miss the 102 the first time round, I know that there's a chance I'll miss it a couple more times. So I was like,
yeah. Sorry, that's brutal.
Yeah.
No.
But nobody wants that.
Brilliant, mate. So in all of that then, what would be your sort of takeaway from the experience of the quarterfinals? It's the first time you've done it?
Yeah, it's the first time I've done it. I suppose what I was surprised about was how relaxed I was and how relaxed it kind of felt like everybody was in a way. I think for a lot of people, the open, once you're kind of the kind of person who would get through to quarterfinals, it's quite easy to put a lot of pressure on your performance at the open. It's going like, this is like, everybody's going to see this. It's kind of public. You want to get through to the next phase. Whereas once you're actually in quarterfinals, athletes like me, we know, well, we're not going any further than this. Like, all of the work has been that we've put in. A, you've done the work already. And B, the work you've put in is so that you get to play at this party, not so that you can get to another party after this one. So enjoy the party that you've got to. And I was surprised at how relaxed I was and how relaxed a lot of other people actually seem to be compared to maybe some of the pressure that we put on ourselves at the open. The other thing, noticing, like doing the quarterfinals at the same gym as Tom Kingdom and Kelly Friel, is that semifinals athletes are a completely different species to quarterfinals athletes.
You know, like when they get the elites to do the open announcements, like you and me, we learn nothing from that. It doesn't help in any sort of, it doesn't translate into any sort of time. You know, like just even to think like that workout, which one you smashed, well, you smashed 24.1, you smashed 24, and to just think that your best effort isn't even close to being a bad effort for them.
Not
seeing
close.
It in the flesh is impressive as well, isn't it? Just like the ability to move and to think. I mean, what time did Tom get on the handstand workout? I presume he finished it.
Oh, do you know, I don't know. And I didn't see him do that one. I didn't see him do that one, so I don't know. But what I did see him do, the clean and jerk workout. And he did 25 clean and jerks. at 111 kilos.
After all,
like, and it was just wild. And then, as well, he was like, he missed one rep, so he would have, if he'd have hit that rep, he'd have got 26. And just sitting there thinking, I know he's going to be annoyed with himself here, because but he's hit 25 reps.
What did you make of the complete body of the tests then? You know, like the quarterfinals, boosh, there they are. These are the things we've got to do. Everyone's got an opinion. What do you think of that?
Well, my honestly selfish opinion is that they were great. Like, I was like, both the open work, the three open workouts we had, the four quarterfinals workouts we had, I was able to get in amongst it. I felt like I was able to do most of the stuff that I'm able to do. I didn't feel like there were loads of things I can do that I left on the table and didn't get the chance to do or anything like that. Now, that's entirely subjective. It's like, how well suited to David McNee do I think they were? But I almost feel like that feedback is like more accurate, because I think a lot of people pretend that they've got a kind of objective analysis of these kind of programmings, whereas actually what they mean is how it felt for me, but I'm going to frame it in an objective way. I'm just going to embrace being subjective. I had a great time. I thought the open was real, worked really well for me, and I was able to join in with all everything that went on at the quarterfinals.
How whether you think it's good or not really is just a reflection of whether it was good for you or not, and let's just be honest about that. Like, if this is the future of CrossFit and the CrossFit Open, I'm there for it, because exactly the same. I could join in. I could play. Yeah. I was happy.
I'll be joining in with the... I'll get to...
I don't really want to do three rounds of pickleball burpee box jump overs again. I would say to make it a funner wad, 50, 40, 30, 20, 10 would have been fine. At least there would have been like some gamifying in your head and like chipping away and things like that. But I also understand that like that mental resilience, being in the midst of that and being able to carry on pushing when it felt like there was no reward, should be a part of CrossFit.
What are you coming away from it going, I've got to be better at, I've got to be better at this by next year?
I don't know, that's a difficult one to answer really, because what I dropped the ball on is what I always drop the ball on, which is strength. And sort of end of last year, beginning of this year, I've sort of resigned myself to never being a decent strength athlete, that I would need to put 20 kilos on my clean and jerk. I would need to put 20 kilos on my snatch for strength to even be like a medium asset for me, which I don't particularly see as being viable. Although if you're telling me you've done it the last 2 years, maybe I'm wrong. You are a much younger man than I am. You're also on a lot more. Oh no, you're on a lot
more. I'm also
more,
a much skinnier man
TRT
than you are,
than
though.
I am as well, I heard. But
do you know HGH tastes delicious?
I'm about 82 at
79 kilos.
Trying to cut. So I'm about 82. I'm normally about 85, 80, 87. So there's that which I know that I'm weak at from the open. You know, an obvious issue with double unders, which I have been addressing. Even during the open, I just got better at double unders. So it's just whether I can be bothered to work on that or not, or whether I'm happy. And like I said, if this is the new CrossFit, then I'm there for it, because like the standard sort of weights I'm all right with. It's when they go heavy that I really struggle. I'm more than all right just getting a score on that clean and jerk workout. I was able to game around the snatches I could have done, but wouldn't have been a good score, that sort of thing. For me, it was more the experience of having having more to juggle general life and submitting the workouts, because one workout a week for 3 weeks I found really manageable, and manageable to the extent of where the cutoffs are, I can have a couple of bites of the cherry. But just how life is for me, work responsibilities, other things that I prioritize, like messing about with my mates and team wars, meant that the two on the Friday and then the two on the Monday was a bit of like, oh, I've got to think about how I'm going to do this. And I did have to block out a little bit of time in my calendar so I could go back on the Friday evening and those sorts of things. So that made it a really different experience, which I actually quite enjoyed. Yeah, I have to be honest with you, because it felt then more as if it was something more serious. It felt like it was like the next level rather than had it been three workouts again over 3 weeks, just harder workouts. I don't think I'd have experienced that in the same way as it being like the next stage of competitions. Generally, I was just happy with WODs, that they yeah. were ones that I could do. I was more than happy with my performance. I always like to be able to think about how could I have done better, because I think that's just an important part of CrossFit anyway, like CrossFit the sport, is that you need to be thinking about yourself, your abilities, your limitations, your strategies. I think that's a really important aspect of it.
I mean, I'm surprised you're not just planning doing a redo weekend for your own sake weekend. That's what I expected you to be like. Having done major analysis.
Well, I've already stated I never want to do this weekend just for me. Again. I'm not sure there'd be much value in being as childish as I was on workout one again. And I think you wouldn't get as good a score if I'd have done the snatches. And I probably will do workout three again at some point when I'm just trying to fill time, you know, wanting to do a double session, wanting to practice rope climbs under fatigue, that sort of thing. I probably will do that again.
Right.
One of the things, I asked a couple of the quarterfinalists from our gym their opinions on it. Some of them were sort of as expected. One of the owners of the gym was just really glad that they were workouts that they could do in a class environment, that they weren't too complicated for people. I think they yeah. liked that element of it as affiliate owners rather than as competitors. But one of the guys I think is a really interesting concept. So he was surprised at the lowering of the skills bar. And his analysis was, if CrossFit continues to yeah. leave the higher skill things until semifinals, then he thinks the trickle down will be that people won't bother learning the skills. Like you and I, we know that we're never going to get to semifinals, so why bother learning to do a handstand walk? You and I know that we're never going to go to semifinals, so why bother learning to do, I don't know, pistols, whatever it is, something that is like the highest skill, that if it's pushed that far off into the distance, then it's never going to, the trickle-down effect will be
yeah.
people won't learn the skills, which I thought was interesting. What do you think about that?
I guess instinctively I go, how much was it actively trickling down beforehand? Like, so last year, you would have needed, the only time you needed to be able to do handstand walks as an example of a high skill thing that a lot of people can't do is if you were an individual, not an age group, quarterfinalist. And so already you were talking about it's only the top 10% who need to be able to do this skill, and it's only the top 10% who are qualifying individually. That rules out the skill level required for their age group quarterfinals last year wasn't the same kind of, you didn't have however far it was, 21 foot or whatever, 25 foot unbroken handstand walk. So I can kind of see the point he's making, that you wouldn't get the trickle down, but that I don't know how much, like, if it was only, it was pretty rarefied air to need to be able to do those things before anyway. And we're CrossFitters, so I don't know how much the trickle down happens because it's enforced upon us, so much as it happens that we're the kind of people who see somebody else doing a thing and go, yeah. I'd quite like to learn how to do that thing. I didn't learn to do muscle-ups because I needed to be able to do them in order to access kind of some special room or an exclusive party. I learned to do muscle-ups because I saw people doing muscle-ups, thought, that looks really cool. I want to learn how to do that. I think that's more commonly the driver of what makes us want to learn high-level skill stuff.
Definite,
but maybe I'm a bit too optimistic about what motivates us.
Degree of truth to that, that whatever we see at the games, well, we want to have a go at it, not because we think it's going to appear in the open, but because we've seen people doing it and it looks like fun, and we, you know, it's just playtime.
Yeah.
On the jungle gym for us in the box, we've got a rig, we've got some ropes, let's see what funny things we can do, which is a way of describing pullovers coming in. But I know for you, there was an element of thinking, well, perhaps pullovers are going to come up in the quarterfinals, so I need to get good at them. So there's like, I can sort of see it from both ways.
Yeah.
In our gym, at least, there were people just trying pullovers because it appeared in the CrossFit Games, and they were like, well, this is a new thing, let's see, I can do the other things, let's see if I can do this as well. But then you are evidence of someone who is like, actually, I think I need to be able to do this in case it comes up.
Yeah. So I think there is a difference there of like learning for like exam revision kind of learning and learning because you enjoy learning things. So I was doing some pullover work a few weeks ago in the like exam revision sense of learning. I was like, it's the semi quarterfinals is only a couple of weeks away. This could come up. I'm going to learn how to do this. That's exam revision kind of learning. But I would also do loads of gymnastics throughout the year because I want to be able to do gymnastics and I want to be able to do those things. And I was able to learn, I'm like in 5 days of doing it every day, I became competent at pullovers. But the reason I was able to become competent at doing pullovers in just 5 days was because I spent a whole year learning gymnastics and, well, more than a year learning gymnastics and developing those skills. I just needed a bit of exam revision before the deadline.
No.
It's not going to stop us doing the year-long learning because we love, because people do CrossFit.
Another element of it is, though, whether those who are programming are going to include those things as often. If, you know, you are on, remind me, Olympus training, and it's like tailor-made for Dave McNee, it's personalized, and his objectives and his goal. They're not going to program stuff. They'll say to you, look, you are thinking about getting through the quarterfinals, going on further. So how can we train you the best to achieve those goals? And if legless rope climbs are something that are only ever seen in the semi-finals, that won't then be part of your regular training. And I guess that would mean it would be down to you to think, oh, I wish I could do it legless like they're doing, you know, sitting on the floor and just going up in an L-sit all of the way, that sort of thing. I still actually agree with you that it doesn't matter whether it's in a comp. Like, I'm practicing handstand walks after I've been to the gym this morning, not because I think they're coming up in the comp that I'm doing in 2 weeks, but it's because it annoys me that there are other people in the gym who can do handstand walks and I can't. And I think it would be pretty cool to be 40 years old, you know, on holiday, doing a handstand walk for a laugh, like just being able to show off. Like, I just want to be able to do it. And it's a thing that exists, so I want to be able to do it. So I agree with you in that as well. So any other concluding thoughts then? Any other pearls of wisdom?
No, I think that's about the full hour that we talked about the quarterfinals is probably about everything I had to say about it. Let the good times of summer off-season programming begin to roll. Pressure off. Just back to training. The training cycle that we're going to start doing, I imagine, is going to include a load of strength stuff and trying to get a bit stronger and all of that kind of jam. But I'm just looking forward to getting on with training and not having to think about competitions peaking.
If my fitness was at a level where I thought anything I did one day affected what I did the next day. Realistically, peaking. Agree. You've got no other competitions lined up, no other sort of out there experiences lined up.
I do have a couple of competitions like that. So it's the British Masters online qualifiers. That's in June. Well, I think
is that the one is, where the lives are probably in doing CrossFit that. Southampton. Yes. Okay. So I've got a feeling quite a few of us are going to give that a shout as well. It's Natalie. So see on the leaderboard.
Oh yeah, jump in. There you go. Oh,
40.
I think are you in the age category above me? Yes, I'm 36. So sadly, we won't be in the same age category. Then I'm doing a competition, male pairs competition in July as well with a mate from the gym here, which is at CrossFit Southampton again. So there's a couple of competitions lined up, but nothing that I'm putting too much pressure myself for. Just having some fun.
That's cool. We've got Fours Comp next weekend in Llanelli. Last year was the first time we did a comp that was outside of the box. So we went and we hired AstroTurf in the leisure centre and the swimming pool. So there was a swimming event and it's happening again 4th of May, I think. And my head was fully in like online qualifier, solo stuff this year. I wasn't going to bother with any teams. I would just go help. But my team from last year was, they wanted to get the band back together. So we're doing that. We've been doing some worm practice actually on Monday, having done 3 and 4 on Monday morning, I went back to the box to do some worm and sandbag practice, which is going to be a major part of it, I imagine. So that's next weekend. And then the weekend immediately after that, I'm taking part in something called Penavan. You know, Penavan, the highest peak in South Wales. Well, you just walk up and down it 10 times in 24 hours, which to me sounds like something a CrossFitter should be able to do. It's just 10 rounds of Penavan. I've got a feeling that I may come unstuck at some point with that relaxed attitude. But yeah, those are the two like really immediate horizon things that I've got going on. Force comp. Male, female, including a swim, and then marching up and down a mountain 10 times in the dark, which can be miserable. But there we go. Oh,
the weather's always good in South Wales.
There can be no danger of doing things outdoor. In May, of course, it's wonderful. It's actually freezing here today. It's gone really cold and it's drizzling. So, there we go. Okay.
Well, yes. Look forward to seeing you at the... British
adjacent
Masters, mate,
to you on the leaderboard. Should we put it like that then? Okay. Well, I just want to say thank you for your input. Thank you for your honesty with the wins that you've had and the mistakes that you've made. And I just want to remind you that tops are done, but CrossFit is not.
Peace. Cheers to the next reader.